Yo man, I've been studying the Roman road technique of evangelism. I'm blown away by the deep scriptural truth that is so clearly presented in this Roman road method. Do you know about it?
I am very suspicious about such evangelical techniques. In my experience, all such techniques are at odds with the doctrine of salvation by sovereign grace, set forth in the Bible. Can you tell me more about the Roman road method?
Sure, I would be glad to. I think you will find that this technique is highly biblical, since it uses verses found in the book of Romans to lead a sinner to Christ.
I hope you are right. Go on.
The Roman road is a pathway you can walk.
Stop right there.
Come on, man. Can't you just listen to what I have to say before you start interrupting me like a hyper-Calvinistic killjoy?
Well, all right, but just let me say this. If man in his natural state is dead in trespasses and in sin, then to tell any old man you see that the Roman road is a pathway he can walk is to deny total depravity. It is therefore not teaching salvation by sovereign grace.
Killjoy.
Please proceed.
The Roman road is a group of Bible verses from the book of Romans in the New Testament. If you walk down this road, you will end up understanding how to be saved.
So the Roman road technique claims to be able to provide an understanding of salvation to carnal men. Is that correct?
Yes.
The Bible's testimony is that the carnal man does not understand such things in Psalm 14:2 and Romans 3:11. Let favor be showed to the wicked, yet will he not learn righteousness. In the land of the upright will he deal unjustly, and will not behold the majesty of the Lord. Isaiah 26:10. It seems the Roman road claims to be capable of providing an understanding that the Bible says is impossible. I wonder, is it possible to make a U-turn on this Roman road?
Well, as we start our journey along this Roman road, we come to Romans 3:23. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We all have sin in our hearts. We all were born with sin and under the power of sin's control. You must admit that you are a sinner.
All right, that's condition number one, admit that you are a sinner. If the carnal man can spiritually discern that he is a sinner, can it be said that he does not understand?
Well, no, of course not.
Paul says there is none that understand death. He is talking about the natural man. The Roman road says that a natural man can understand such things. Paul says they cannot. Your Roman road seems to be going nowhere fast. I'm looking for an off-ramp.
Our second stop along this Roman road is Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. Sin has an ending that results in death. All lost people will end up in the lake of fire for all eternity. You must understand that you deserve death for your sin.
That's condition number two, understand that you deserve death for your sin. Did I mention that Paul said there is none that understand death?
As we continue along the Roman road, we come to Romans 6:23, part B. But the gift of God is eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Salvation is a free gift. You cannot earn this gift, but you must reach out and receive it. Ask God to forgive you and save you.
That's conditions number three and four, reach out and receive a gift, and ask God to forgive and save you. Let me get this straight, you are saying that until you reach out and receive the gift and ask God to save you, you are not in possession of eternal life. Is that right?
That is correct. You must reach out and ask God to save you in order to receive eternal life.
But an unsaved man is dead in trespasses and in sin. That means that you are asking a dead man to do something. That's expecting a lot of a dead man, don't you think? If he's spiritually dead, then he cannot do anything spiritual. It follows that anything he can do is done in the flesh. In John 6:63, the Lord Jesus Christ taught us that the flesh profiteth nothing where eternal life is concerned. So you see, if man is spiritually dead, he cannot meet any of these four conditions, or, for that matter, any spiritual conditions whatsoever. There's no two ways around it. If you are telling a dead man to do something in order to obtain eternal life, then you are violating depravity, and you are not teaching salvation by sovereign grace. If you are able to do spiritual things, such as admit, understand, receive, believe, or ask God to save you, then you are a spiritual man and thus already in possession of eternal life prior to performing any of these acts. Thus regeneration precedes faith and salvation is by sovereign grace.
I wish you would stop poking your head out from under your hard shell, Mossback.
Please go on.
The next stop along our Roman road is Romans 5, 8. God demonstrates his own love for us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. When Jesus died on the cross, he paid sin's penalty. He paid the price for all sin. When he took all the sins of the world on himself on the cross, he bought us out of slavery to sin and death. The only condition is that we believe in him and what he has done for us, understanding that we are now joined with him, and that he is our life.
Wow. I almost don't know where to start with this one.
Yeah, dude. Do you see the power of the Roman road? It is a veritable superhighway that leads to everlasting life. I think this is working. I'd better keep going. Give your life to God. His love bought you out of being a slave to sin. His love is what saves you, not religion or church membership. God loves you, man.
Well, there are conditions 5 and 6. Give your life to God and believe in him and what he has done. There's so much to address here. Let me just say this. First, if Christ paid the sins of the whole world and his work was effectual, then all will be saved. If they are not saved, then Christ's work did not get the job done, and that is an Arminian monstrosity. Second, we have listed 6 conditions that must be met thus far, and yet, the Roman road says that condition number 6 is the only condition. It occurs to me that the Roman road is either dishonest or incapable of understanding simple arithmetic. Regardless, the fundamental flaw remains, and that is simply this. Salvation is not conditioned upon any act of man whatsoever. It is by sovereign grace alone. It is an act of God alone. It does not require any act on the part of man, any act at all. It cannot, because man is spiritually dead. It follows then that any spiritual act you see a man perform, be it admitting, accepting, receiving, repenting, believing, asking, or seeking, is the result of a salvation already imparted in immediate Holy Spirit regeneration, and not a prerequisite to eternal life that must be met by man. That, my brother, is salvation by sovereign grace.